I love music. I love bands. I go and see groups. I'm really into that. I hate the music business, period, anyway.
Rock wives, rock chicks, and rock widows.
I was never in love with Ike that way. I didn't want Ike, and Ike didn't want me.
Rock Widows, part three of Rock Wives, a series on sex, love, and rock and roll with Miranda Sawyer. Starts now. 97 to 99 FM.
Radio 1.
I was always looking for a Prince Charming with a guitar, drumsticks, or microphone. And I wanted, you know, a long-term marriage with a rock guy.
Hello, I'm Miranda Sawyer. Over the last 2 weeks in Rock Wife, we've shared a wiggle and a giggle with the rock chicks, the daydream believers who live and love for the magic touch of fame, the happy-go groupies of pop. And we've met the rock wives, the ones who keep dinner, baby, and marriage a-bubbling for when hubby deigns to come home. We took a duster to the households of pop and found a mildly disgruntled Mrs. Rock, a woman who stored her own ego in the basement to make room for her man's. This week, we turn to the survivors, the merry widows of rock.
So it was a complete battle, it was a total nightmare. I was constantly battling against his lifestyle with my sort of wanting to have this pure spiritual life. So we were total opposites.
Playboy bunnies would throw themselves at his feet. I mean, you know, I didn't stand a chance. I knew he was, you know, bonking left, right, and center, but there's no way you can stop it.
As soon as I started feeling resentful around David, I had to leave. Being banished to Switzerland, I started to feel resentful. I had to leave.
All relationships can be tricky, uncommunicative, uncommunal. But the rock marriage is trickier than most. In many cases, the rock wife turns rock widow when her ring's still on her finger. Touring can physically remove her beloved for two-thirds of the year, and its aftermath, alcohol and glory come down, can put more emotional distance between a couple than many could cope with.
At first, it was supposed to be 6 months, and then it went into, like, 12 months, and then it kept on getting longer. So then I got fed up with it, and I thought, you know what, I don't want to be on an aeroplane packing a suitcase every single day.
Plus, the music industry is always suspicious of the rock wife. Her stay-at-home desires are in direct competition with the desires of the fans, the record company, and the behind-the-scenes money men who want to see their rock star out there and earning. And, sorry, Cupid, there are many rock unions that are not solely based on love. Money, status, ambition, second-hand success. The rock wife who goes in with her eye for a bargain may get more than she bargained for.
Anybody who's ambitious enough to get to the top and become famous is driven by a fundamental lack inside themselves, which is why so many of them come a cropper.
So this week, let's put our hands together for the women who made it. The post-pop divorcees, the rock wives who came out the other side. Ladies, gentlemen, and your respective lawyers, rock widows.
Girl! You gonna get a job instead of wishing from the top.
What's love gonna do with it? It's so unrealistic that I can't find an answer.
Tina Turner started out as a sidekick, a support system, doing everything she could to get Ike Turner where he wanted to be. She spent 16 years trying to make him a megastar, then walked away and showed him how to do it.
When I entered Ike's life, as I told you, he was already a star. Big house, diamonds, Cadillac. This man was already a star to me, you know? And I didn't know about stars. I didn't think about stars. I only knew about movie stars. And it was really emotional. He told me about his whole trip from leaving Mississippi by foot, you know, hitchhiking to Memphis. And getting to know a record company there that taught him. Actually, he was the A&R man for a record company and talent scout. So that was his expertise, you know. But he wanted to get on stage and be a star. And he had always had problems with how he looked. They didn't think he was attractive. The attractive men were mulatto-looking guys and driving big cars. So he had a hard time. And I feel sorry for him.
The
nothing on my mind. Won't somebody please, please tell me what's wrong? You're just a fool. You know you're in love.
And he had been nice to me when I first met him, when he finally took me under his wing, so to speak, and very nice to me, like we're talking financially. I had dental problems, wouldn't work, and he bought me clothes and clothes for stage, but also singing, he would give me extra money, and I bought some school clothes. No. So we became friends, really close friends. So when he told me the story, I said, I won't leave you. He can sing. He could sing then, but he wasn't confident and he was shy. So my mission, how I saw it then, is that I was doing this for Ike.
Although she was the singer, Tina didn't feel like a star, even when A Fall in Love became a hit in 1960. She says she didn't even like the song, couldn't relate to what it was all about, having never had a boyfriend apart from Ike. She was just Anna May, 21 years old, a young woman giving her all for her old man.
Ike and Tina Turner. The whole time that the involvement that I got into was giving this to him because I thought he deserved it. And then he came in to visit me at the hospital. And I said, what's his name? He says, well, I changed the name because didn't sound like a good stage name, you know. It was really taking over, just took over my life. And, well, I had no say because at that time I was, you know, becoming more afraid of him and still being loyal, and so it was a mixture of, I'm sure a psychiatrist would put a title to it, but I was just this young girl that caught into this commitment. I was never in love with Ike that way. I didn't want Ike, and Ike didn't want me. What happened is Ike was trying to secure himself to have a singer. Maybe that's why he had sex with me. It was ugly. I've said this. I don't know how many more times I have to say it. Oh, it was always an uncomfortable relationship. The love. It was a love, but it wasn't a love between man and woman in a healthy kind of way. It was another infatuation, fear, devotion, and all of that. I told Ike, after being with him for 1 year, he was still with his wife, but also there were then the Ikeettes, and he was fornicating around there, and I knew that this was not a happy situation. And I told him that I wouldn't be with him once I helped him to get what I had promised for. And that was the real commitment. I really meant that. But in spite of it, I don't have an answer for you to tell you why I went on and ended up like 16 years with this man. I can only say that mentally, I was nowhere near as I am now, because there was no place to go, really. Where would I have gone to? Just back home to try to work, and I was the star, you know? What would they have done without me? Who was going to be Tina? I think I just couldn't think of a way out. Everything was fine until the drug scene came, because then it became disrespectful in every aspect, the drugs at the house, the kids, and the whole thing. And then the plan started that after the kids graduated from school, that would be the easiest time to leave. And that was the plan, and that's actually what happened.
It was June 1976, when Tina was 37 years old, that she finally put her plan into action. She left Ike, asking for $5,000 a month alimony, plus $1,000 a month child support for their two sons. She ended up, after a long, bitter dispute, with her writing royalties, two Jaguars, and the clothes on her back. In the end, she just couldn't be bothered to fight. She'd won her freedom, and that was what she really wanted. Music making has always been anti-monogamy. Rock and marriage go together like a horse and light aircraft. Bill Ware's a session musician who plays with the Groove Collective, the Jazz Passengers and Steely Dan. He has no qualms about using his instrument technique as an instrumental technique in furthering his real hobby, girls. He's never been a one to say no to a one-on-three après-gig champagne jacuzzi, and who can blame him? Young, good-looking, talented. He has suffered from long-lasting relationships in the past, but he's all right now. He's married only to the loving life of rock.
I'm a very different kind of guy, yes. And I'm also sort of like a fanatic music-wise. I just want to play all the time. I sit at the keyboard and play, and it doesn't leave a lot of time. I'm just not normal, I guess. The music is always first. Until I find somebody to change that. It's hard to find, especially if you're not looking for all the typical things that somebody's gonna look for in a relationship. Like stability, sanity. Sex, yes. Passion, yes. Treat you like a queen, yes. I believe in compromise. I'm just like, when it comes to monogamy.
Monogamy is not quite what this next pair are looking for. Kolodny and Anto are an LA-based firm of family lawyers who mostly deal with people from the music and entertainment industry. They are big shot bigwigs who make a pretty penny mopping up the end of high-profile rock weddings. They handled the divorce of Sean Penn and Madonna, plus lots of heavy metal, heavy situations. Def Leppard, Steve Adler of Guns N' Roses, and they divorced two of Motley Crue, including Tommy Lee, who went right off and married again, shotgun style, to Pamela Anderson.
I think that in the rock and roll industry, the performers have too much available to them, whether it be the adoring fans, alcohol, drugs. They work at a real high pitch when they're performing. And when they get through, they need a release. And too often, they find it in somebody other than, let's say, their wife. I mean, it's a hard life. They travel from place to place. They do a setup. They practice. They do their sound checks. They then have a bite to eat. They get dressed. They come out. They perform for 2-3 hours. And then they're at this high pitch, and they stop. So what do? They party hardy. And at that point, the life at home, it's gone. The client who's been on tour now for 8-9 months, when he was married and he was on tour, he would see the wife and the children maybe 2-3 times a year. One has to feel sorry for an individual who is in rock and roll, because for them to maintain a close and personal relationship with another person on an ongoing basis is nearly impossible. Because if they're going to be successful and if they're going to perform, you'll find the only way a rock and roller can make money is to go on tour, go to the clubs, to perform to the public, because that's when they sell. You may have the same thing with anyone who is in a high-profile business or profession. The main difference is in the rock and roll industry, the roadie goes out at the end of the concert and collects pieces of personal adornment or keys from willing ladies, shall we say, who want to meet and be with these performers. So my advice to anyone in the rock and roll industry is stay single and enjoy and be safe.
Johnny Allen is a man who can. A heavy metal roadie who's been in the business for 35 long years, he has long-standing groupies lying down for him in every corner of the world. He's such a regular now that some even bake cakes for him when he arrives. He also has a girlfriend at home, but she knows how important she is.
I could be in the midst of something at home, and if I got a phone call to go and take care of one of the bands that I take care of, I would be going to do it, because that's what I do. They trust me to take care of them. when people say, "What, you're not married yet?" And I say, "Well, I'm married in this business. That's probably as married as I'm going to get." This is where I'll be for a long, long time to come, I hope.
If you can handle the off of an on-off relationship, then such music men are for you. But what of the main man, the rock star who marries? And what of the good rock wife who takes him on? A sad and staggering 70% of rock weddings fail to make the distance. Married life is no life for a self-obsessed emotional retard whose social skills depend on how many chemical volivants he's guzzled and who wouldn't recognise a gas bill if it bit him on the plectrum. Victoria Clark came along for the tour for the first 10 years of her relationship with Shane McGowan, ex-Pogues, now lead singer in the Pogues. Now she's left the nasty stuff behind.
There was one woman who used to phone me very, very threatening and say things like, you know, if I were you, I wouldn't get on the next tour bus. I wouldn't go to the next gig because I'm going to be there, you know, and I'm the woman that he really wants. And like, they've just got, they've, well, anybody now who, I'm usually very patient now. In the past, I would really lose it, you know, I'd really lose it. Like, I'm quite violent if I do. And, but, you know, I did used to attack him physically. And I don't think that's very good for you to have that happening all the time. I think you need to kind of get at the cause of it, remove the cause. And I think for me, the cause was actually trying to stop him drinking, which is a totally lost cause, and living with him, you know, which is another totally lost cause. I was definitely forced into finding tranquility and serenity and sanity by the situation I was in, which was completely mad, and I was very, very, very unhappy. You know, so it was like suicide or some sort of solution for me at that point. And, you know, I sort of tried taking too many drugs and sort of blacking things out myself, and I tried things like just staying in bed for, you know, all day, every day, you know, and not being able to go out and all those sort of things. And eventually I was very lucky, you know, I discovered that, you know, there is something you can do. There's a light at the end of the tunnel. I'm very naturally attracted to white walls and like high ceilings and big windows and lots of light and space. And I don't like clutter. I like things to be clean. And Shane's quite the opposite. He likes dark colours on walls. He likes sort of red and purple and colours like black. Ideally, I think, black on the wall. And he likes the curtains shut in the daytime. Doesn't like the daylight much. And he likes to accumulate everything. Everything that he buys sort of gets accumulated and nothing ever gets thrown away. So, like, you know, the empty wrappers and stuff just sort of pile up and the empty bottles and things. And, you know, you have the TV on 24 hours a day watching videos and stuff, and I really don't like that. So it was a complete battle. It was a total nightmare. I was constantly battling against his lifestyle with my sort of wanting to have this pure spiritual life. So we were total opposites. And so, like, I'd be sitting there meditating, and him and his friends would be all sitting around watching a violent movie like Bad Lieutenant or Reservoir Dogs. And, like, you know, they'd be sort of, like, you know, chain-smoking and, like, drinking and doing everything. And, you know, I'd be sort of struggling against that.
Victoria was a rock widow even whilst she was a rock wife. She's moved out from Shane now, and her rock relationship, though unconventional, is a success. The pair live in separate places, and she stopped trying to change his chosen lifestyle. She stopped trying to stop him drinking. She stopped opening his curtains in the middle of the day. She stopped trying to clear up his interesting decor. She has accepted Shane's rock life, but learned to live her own. Barney Hoskins is an English music journalist living part-time in America. He became so fascinated by the sordid excesses of the LA music scene that he's written a whole book about it, Waiting for the Sun. He spoke to hundreds of the ladies of rock, rock chicks, rock wives, rock widows, and he thinks that they emerge with at least some sort of skewed integrity.
More than a few of the guys that they had sex with are no longer with us, but they're okay. You know, they learned something from the experience, and they can talk about it with a sense of humor, with a sense of irony. They knew what they were doing, and in a sense, you could say that at the end of the day, they were the ones that were in control. They were more together when it was all over than the people on stage, because at least they weren't suffering delusions of grandeur by being on stage every night and then sort of wondering why it wasn't always like that, which is more than can be said for, you know, I don't know, whoever the drummer was in this, you know, who was being sexually serviced and pharmaceutically serviced every night and just living this totally kind of slob-like hedonistic existence. You know, the bottom line is that the thing is set up so that men don't have to grow up. Women have to grow up, but men don't really have to if they don't want to. They're allowed to behave like totally selfish little boys for as long as they want, provided they're famous and rich or whatever, you know?
Meet Gary Richwald, LA disease investigator, a private dick for two public dicking, forever on the trail of the sort of tricky diseases given freely with free love. He's one of 24,000 physicians practicing in LA County, and he's the director of the sexually transmitted disease program in that area. Gary well knows, and Gary knows well, that despite LA's clean living protestations, nasty, germ-ridden sex is alive and jumping in them there Hollywood hills. The programme is always busy. This is what happens. Gary's envoy goes Avon calling, rings the bell on a Rockwise door and politely explains to her that we have reason to believe that someone you know intimately has an STD and we'd like to offer you free testing. Lock up your privacy, it's the door-to-door sex police.
When I sit back and look at MTV or read the trade publications or watch the award shows, which are all too numerous, you know, some of those people are number one on our list as well as on the Grammys and others. And, you know, some of them don't learn. I mean, all of us have our difficulties in one area or another. Some of these people are just currently very sexually active. It's kind of like they're in a candy store in a way, and they're addicted to having very frequent sex with very many different people without any sense of protection and, for themselves or the other person. Everybody thinks that their musical idol is only sleeping with them. I realize it may be completely irrational. In fact, it is. It's more than irrational. It's unrealistic. But, you know, people just have surreal fantasies about what this individual's doing the rest of their time. And so people are in denial. We use a number of techniques generally called disease control. And one of the techniques is we do an investigation called a cluster investigation, where we will interview not just the people who are her sex partners, but maybe all the people she associates with. In terms of the rock industry and the film industry, we do find clusters where we will identify people. We've had a number of cases in the last few years in Los Angeles where someone who has had sex with a group of musicians, one or more of them, usually in a party type setting, in a hotel or in a, you know, a house in the Hollywood Hills, some idyllic setting usually. Usually under the influence of alcohol and drugs, usually in what's described as sort of a spontaneous event and celebration, inevitably without condoms, that we find that these kinds of cases come to our attention commonly. And we will speak to those individuals and investigate the cases. If those rock musicians live here in Los Angeles, we will interview them, offer them testing. They may have private physicians. They may not want to go to their private physician. their private physician may be also the private physician for their girlfriend or wife. But we have had, like I say, a number of clusters. People have named their contacts. Groupies know other groupies. And this has led to a number of cases being discovered that wouldn't have otherwise been discovered, treated, etc.
If that doesn't put you off, then nothing will. No wonder Perry Lister left her rock star Billy Idol to find a decent life for her and their son. But like Shane McGowan's girlfriend Victoria, Perry only left when she tried everything else first and failed.
I have the time, so I will say yeah. I'm just a boy.
And you know, we're soulmates and we will be forever. We're still best of friends, even though, you know, I left him 7 years ago. But I didn't do the rock star wife thing and like take him to the cleaners and ask him for everything he got. We didn't have any lawyers involved at all because we both hate lawyers so much. I just, you know, said to him, Billy, you know, paid for Willem's school bills and his teeth and all whatever. And, you know, that's it. So we didn't have a horrible falling out. We just sort of left amicably and everything was okay. So when we go to the school PTA meetings, we go together, you know, because we're friends. We just had that thing that we were so... We're so alike, and we had that soulmate thing, and I knew that we'd always come back together, whatever happened in the interim.
Travel and unwind my own truth, yeah. I've laid my head on the rock of youth, yeah. I trusted and then broken my own world just to keep me free in this mad, mad world. It could happen to you, so think for yourself. If I should stumble, that's my fault, yeah. If I should stumble,
rock and roll life, it's just all about that. It's about people, you know, you're sort of a semi-god, you know. When we wanted to have a child, that's why we moved to LA, because New York was the party life and you're up all night and you sleep all day and all that sort of thing. So then we moved to LA and we had Willem and we had a daytime life, you know. He got a motorbike and he would hang out in the daytime and we'd work out, actually go to a gym and things. Actually, we had a gym built in the house, so we didn't have to go to a gym. But yeah, it was completely different when we came to LA. It was a lot different. And it's not like having a baby. I didn't think it was going to change Billy into being a normal human being or anything. But I didn't think he would get worse. And he actually, I think it kind of freaked him out becoming a dad. And he had to prove to the world that he was still Mr. Rock and Roll. And so he started hanging out in strip bars and you know, the most gross, disgusting places. And you know, and of course the... Just the lifestyle wasn't... I was growing because I'd had a child and I was becoming a mother and I was changing, but Billy didn't change then. He's changed now, but he didn't change then. He was still too young and too into the rock star life and he didn't, you know... Oh, I just thought there's got to be more to life than this, and I got a part in a film and I got a part in a play and I sort of got my life back together again after having a baby and not just being the mother at home, you know. And I had the luxury of having the money to have a nanny, and So when I was doing the play and I was doing the movie, I realised, oh, yes, I'm appreciated as a human being, because I felt really neglected and, you know, a bit overweight from having the baby. And then when I got my life back together, I realised that, no, I can't live like this. I don't want Billy out all night in the studio or out all night doing this. I want a life, and I need a, you know, a family and a community and somewhere for them to grow up. And I just didn't think it was right. You know, I don't know if I did the right thing.